So having that optimality gap in mind, now there is a general way to test the so-called average case performance of a heuristic algorithm. That obviously is somewhat different from testing one solution. Now we want to test an algorithm. So we somehow need to generate a lot of instances, okay? And we typically randomly generate these instances. Once we generate a lot of instances, a lot of testing cases, we input all these instances into an algorithm that is proposed by us, and also we do an exact algorithm, for example, branch and bound, to find the optimized objective value. So this gives us Z star, this gives us Z ALG, and for case I, we get Z star I and Z average I. So that's going to help us to calculate all those percentage errors. More precisely, suppose we are talking about a maximization problem, then we're going to do that for each instance. And we're going to do that for each instance to calculate this percentage error. For all these percentage errors, we sum them up and then divide everything by n. So we take average percentage errors. For the first instance, that's 11%, 11%, the second one 22%, the next one 3%, and so on and so on. We try to do the average percentage error. If we have two algorithms where one has lower average percentage error, then we say, well, it seems to us that this algorithm performs better. It has a better average case performance. However, there's also one thing that is very interesting. The thing is that if you are doing this, then if you are able to find an exact solution, what's the point of using the heuristic? It's pretty much because the only possibility for you to find an optimal solution is for your problem to have small scale. For example, if it is a knapsack problem, maybe it only have 20, 30 variables instead of thousands. Okay, so we somehow hope to test the performance of a heuristic with realistic situations. So we may need to test our heuristic in large scale problems. But if that's the case, when we generate a lot of large scale random instances, there is no way to solve for an optimal solution. That's too time consuming, right? So people do another way. People is going to find an upper bound for a maximization problem. People try to find an upper bound of the objective value of an optimal solution. Okay, so an optimal solution cannot be found, but we may find its upper bound through what? For example, linear relaxation. Okay, you probably still remember that at the very beginning of this lecture, we say whenever you have an integer program for a maximization problem, if you do linear relaxation, it's going to give you an upper bound. So let's say this value is called ZLR. ZLR is going to be no less than Z star. It's going to be an upper bound for that optimized objective value. This ZLR may be easier to be obtained. Solving an integer program is hard, but solving a linear program is much easier. So you may obtain ZLR and then use ZLR as your evaluation criteria, use as your benchmark. So you use ZLR to replace Z star in your formula. Okay? You use this to estimate the percentage error, which is the difference between the ZLR, between your upper bound of your optimized objective value with your proposed solution. So in this case, that average percentage error is also actually an upper bound for that calculated with an optimal solution. So here I need to spend a few words to make the thing clearer. So please give me a few seconds. Okay, so one thing we want to calculate is Z star minus Z ALG, okay? This is going to be our ideal optimality gap. But this is too difficult to be calculated. So that's why you will use, for example, ZLR. And we use ZLR to do the subtraction. Once we do that, we would agree that because ZLR itself is no less than Z star. So the optimality gap here is going to be that if you use ZLR, it's going to be greater than or equal to that optimality gap using your objective value. Okay, so this is going to be true. And once we have that, pretty much we can say this ZLR, using that as your denominator, is going to also be greater than or equal to that calculated by using the optimized objective value. Well, when you see this, it's going to be somewhat interesting. Because when this is the case, this is to divide something that is larger, right? So you need to have some derivations. So for here and there, don't forget that this is 1 minus ZLG divided by Z star. And this is 1 minus ZLG divided by ZLR. Okay, ZLR is larger, so the whole thing here is smaller. So once you use 1 and subtract that, the whole thing here, that or fractional, is indeed larger. Okay, so hopefully you are convinced that this is the case. So this is how we explain the fact that this particular average percentage error calculated with your upper bound provides again an upper bound for the actual average percentage. And that's going to give us a hint about how good our algorithm is. So in this above example, let's say linear relaxation. Linear relaxation gives us a solution, which is here, okay? This is not too unfamiliar for you. We're going to have this 0.6, and this gives you 9.8. So suppose you don't have an optimal solution, you are still able to calculate the absolute optimality gap and the relative or the percentage optimality gap. Okay, so this somehow means estimating the optimality gap is not so difficult, because the heuristic can be done in a very short time. And your linear relaxation can also be solved in a very short time. So solving this optimality gap is much easier than solving the exact optimality gap.